Our first speaker is Tomaš Tengely Evans, who's a journalist on Socialist Worker. Tomaš is going to speak for about 15 minutes.
Thanks. I think we've got to be absolutely clear about this. Ukraine is being torn apart by the imperialist rivalry between the West and Russia. And the two dominant narratives that you have about the crisis, on the one hand, the dominant one in the West, in the media, is that this is simply a question of Russian aggression against a fight for democracy, is false. But also the other one that's dominating, certainly within the anti-war movement, which is that this is simply a question of the West, of NATO expansion, and of Russia being somehow a passive power reacting to events, is also false. The Ukraine crisis itself was never about national independence. It was never about democracy. It was about which of these rival blocs Ukraine would be part of, and that's what's playing out today. But I'm not actually going to focus on the specific political situation within Ukraine itself. I think it's important to locate what's going on within the broader regional and also global context of imperialism. And I think, first of all, what we have to do is understand what imperialism actually is, and also how it's playing out today in terms of the global pecking order within the imperialist system. But also, we have to sort of look at the legacy of Stalinism on sort of politics within Eastern Europe, and how that has a bearing on events that take place. Now, when it came to Ukraine, neither the West, the US, the EU, nor Russia wanted to risk a full-scale sort of military conflict. Neither side is strong enough in the current conflict to deliver the killer blow. Both have to rely on proxies. The West is backing the government in Kiev. And you can actually see how they try and back them and give them the free ride. If you think about the Greek debt crisis, they're crucifying Greece and trying to make them totally capitulate. But when it comes to Ukraine's debt, they're giving them an absolutely free ride on it because it is in their imperialist interests to do so. And Russia, on the other hand, is backing the separatist forces within the East. Now, when George Bush Sr. in 1991, at the end of the Cold War, declared the New World Order, and he said that what we say goes, it wasn't supposed to be like this. The US emerged out of the Cold War as being the only superpower. And I think this sort of experience informs the dominant view of imperialism, that imperialism is simply a question of US power. But imperialism is not reducible to US power or Russian aggression. It's actually imperialism for us is about a global system of competing capitals and capitalist states. And what this theory, Marxist theory of imperialism that was developed, it's when capitalism develops and firms grow larger, that sort of economic competition becomes competition on a global scale between capitalist states and can spill over into military competition sometimes. But the point is, this is not a static system. Because the world economy develops at different rates, everything can change, and which power is dominant can change quite quickly. And it wasn't the case when Bush declared in 1991 that this is what we say goes, that the US was able to simply assert its hegemony in that sort of way. The serial war criminal Henry Kissinger said that actually the US is in no better position to dictate the global agenda unilaterally any more than it was at the beginning of the Cold War. The United States will face economic competition of a kind never experienced before. And that's what we're seeing today with the rise of China. They're facing intense economic competition from China, and Southeast Asia is in fact one of the main areas where the US imperialism would like to have its focus, and we can see sort of the pivot towards Asia there. But continually, it's been dragged back by events. You can see in the Middle East, it's having to deal with the crisis around ISIS. It's having to deal with what's taking place within Libya and Syria. And also, the crisis within Ukraine has also meant this is another flashpoint that US imperialism is having to focus on yet again. And it's important to say that the US is still the world's dominant superpower, is still the biggest threat to peace in the world. But what we can see when it comes to these rising powers, which are sort of competing with it economically, you can see that they're able to exert a certain influence on the periphery of their borders. And this is crucially what Russia has been trying to do. And when it comes to Russia, I think what we have to do is look at its relationship to its so-called near abroad, the sort of 15 republics that form part of the Soviet Empire, and how it's sort of tried to maintain some form of dominance and control over them. Now, in 1991, when the Soviet Union collapsed, there was an intense social crisis within Russia because of the sort of neoliberal shock therapy that was pushed through by sort of people like Boris Yeltsin and pushed by the Washington Consensus in the West and so forth. And it had absolutely horrific consequences, GDP down by 57% from 1991 levels and so on and so forth. But this also hit the military-industrial complex within Russia. You could see that the once mighty Soviet army was reduced to a husk of its former self. So instead, what Russia sought to do was to foment nationalist and ethnic divisions, and you can see the greater Russian chauvinism is still a big touchstone when it comes to Russian imperialist strategy. If you think about what's going on in the Crimea, it would try to use greater Russian chauvinism to justify its annexation there. So between 1991 and 1994, they tried to sort of foment a series of civil wars and separatist conflicts within its near abroad in order to try and weaken and destabilize those countries. So we saw Georgia, we saw Ingushetia, and also they tried to have us foment the civil war between Armenia and Azerbaijan. The total death toll here was 170,000 and 1.5 million refugees. But there was one actually key case, which is Chechnya, which I just want to briefly touch on, because actually here you saw in 1991 they declared independence. This was sort of the one. This was sort of one area where Yeltsin couldn't sort of regain control. And his sort of strategy in Chechnya wasn't just about them declaring independence. It was supposed to be about actually Russia once again asserting its dominance, asserting its control within its near abroad. What we saw was in 1994, they were defeated because they saw sort of internal opposition within Chechnya itself. They couldn't defeat them militarily, but also in Russia itself, there was opposition to both the neoliberal shock therapy and to the fact they were pursuing this war within Chechnya. The turning point comes when Yeltsin essentially is asked to step aside, despite being backed by the West in the election, and Vladimir Putin comes along. What he manages to do is sort of unite behind him these different rival groups of oligarchs and to try and sort of centralize the Russian state and make sure that they're able to both consolidate the economy and much more be able to sort of compete and exert their imperialist influence. Putin exploits divisions within the Chechen ranks to sort of defeat this, and also the spike in the oil prices in the 2000s and the energy prices means that they're in a much stronger position to both fund the army, but also to use their energy in order as a form of blackmail, or to try and sort of use that within inserting their imperialist interests. I think it's important to say, though, that there are limits to all of this, of course. The Ukraine crisis has exposed some of them. And also, when you think about the imposition of sanctions by the US and the European Union, this has caused a profound economic crisis within Russia. They were talking about currency and capital controls back in January. And also, Russia is now also the signs of recession. And this could mean serious trouble for the Russian ruling class, because whenever there's an economic downturn within Russia, this is where you can see opposition to Putin coming up internally. But I think also it's quite what we also have to say about sort of the Ukraine crisis and imperialism is also, if you think about it, Russia's strategy of creating this sort of exerting influence over the near abroad was also about creating a Eurasian customs union as being one of the methods of doing this. And Ukraine was the pivot in all of this. It was the key state in order to try and achieve this. The reason is, of course, that Ukraine was the second most industrialized country within the former Soviet Empire, and also it's a key sort of area. Now, if Ukraine were to go towards a more Western influence, as was seeming it was going, that would scupper these plans. But it wasn't just about competition between the European Union and Russia. It was also, when it came to the Central Asian republics, what Russia was seeing was intense competition from China and the possibility that China could assert its imperialist interests within Central Asia. So therefore, it was trying to battle against Chinese competition by consolidating control there as well. So it's all linked. And what we can see is that it actually is about that sort of inter-imperialist rivalry between multiple capitalist imperialist states, as opposed to just it be as opposed to just being about one power being showing aggression towards another. How am I doing, for example?
Five.
I've got 5 minutes. Okay. The other thing that I sort of want to touch on is actually what the impact of sort of Stalinism on sort of the politics of Eastern Europe and how this shapes some of the developments and debates that are taking place. And I think it's important to say that we in the Socialist Workers' Party stand a tradition that did not see the Russia and the Eastern Bloc as being in any way socialist. We see them as being a state capitalist regimes where the state bureaucracy was a ruling class locked into competition, both economic and military, with the West and exploited workers and in terms of the drive to accumulation, just like the Western ruling classes did. 1989 was something that we supported. We supported the fall of the Berlin Wall, but the problem was that it simply went from state capitalism to free market capitalism. That was a sidestep in that way, but that shadow is still cast over it. So when you do see movements spring up within sort of Eastern Europe, and you do see left-wing groups within Eastern Europe, a lot of the time they're torn between seeing either do we look towards the West and the market as being some sort of alternative, or do you simply look towards trying to rescue the so-called best bits of the old system from that sort of way. And this sort of legacy of Stalinism, combined with what we're seeing generally, which is a low level of struggle for the last 30 years, has meant that when it comes to looking for the alternatives to these crises, people aren't looking towards the organized working class as a social force that can change the situation and actually challenge both sort of the ruling classes and the and imperialism. And I think when it comes to us, what it means, what the Ukraine crisis means for us as the as socialists within Britain, it means about how we oppose imperialism. And when it comes to opposing imperialism, we take what Karl Liebknecht, the German revolutionary Karl Liebknecht, said: the main enemy is at home. And the policy that was being argued by people like Liebknecht and also Lenin during the First World War was one of defeatism. You were for the defeat of your own ruling class. Now, people asked Lenin, you know, saying, how can every ruling class be defeated? How can everyone lose? Well, the point is that they can lose and we can win, because we have to strike our own ruling class, because that's where our own working class is able to make that sort of blow. But actually, it's part of an international struggle to turn the bosses' war into a war against the bosses. So while socialists in different countries, whether that's in Ukraine and in Britain, have different immediate concrete tasks to do, we are informed by the same sort of principles that actually we have to challenge imperialism, challenge our own ruling class, but also that the working class is the only solution to that sort of problem there. And I just want to sort of read out a passage from Tony Clift during the Korean War, which was written, and he wrote this: in their mad rush for profit, for wealth, the two gigantic imperialist powers are threatening the existence of world civilization, are threatening humanity with the terrible suffering of atomic war. The interests of the working class of humanity demand that neither the imperialist world powers be supported, that both be struggled against. That battle cry of the real, genuine socialists today must be neither Washington nor Moscow, but international socialism.
Thanks, Tomaš. Our next speaker is Volodymyr Ishchenko, who is a Ukrainian socialist who will be looking at things from the more Ukrainian point of view.
Thank you for inviting me to speak here, and thank you, Tomaš, for giving such a big global introduction to competition of imperialisms on the global scale. And indeed, we see a competition of imperialism actually, I would like to see it. Sorry. Yeah, but I can speak louder. I was going to focus more on the state of Ukrainian left, what happened during Maidan movements and anti-Maidan movements with Ukrainian left, what we had there, and what is happening now, and some lessons we draw from our experience in our country. And I think that these lessons are actually very relevant for the global left, international left as well, and showing quite a deep crisis that the left is undergoing now, which enabled so many people, committed socialists, to become voluntary supporters of either this or that side of the imperialist competition. So Yeah, Tomaš already mentioned that what we see in Ukraine is actually neither of the dominant narratives which were promoted either by Western propaganda or by Russian propaganda. So it was not a democratic revolution that only Russia tried to repress with a counter-revolutionary intervention in eastern Ukraine and in Crimea. And on the other hand, it was not a fascist coup d'etat in the interest of the Western imperialism in repressing so-called proletarian revolt in eastern Ukraine, as so many leftists were, especially in the West, were trying to present the Donbass revolt in these terms. It was not an anti-fascist revolt against the fascist state. And what we see is competition of nationalisms and imperialism, Ukrainian-Russian nationalism, and Russian and EU-US imperialisms, which actually have quite, to a certain extent, different interests. And in this competition, we cannot find any fundamentally more progressive side to support, speaking from the point of revolutionary Marxism. So Maidan movement and anti-Maidan movement were not really symmetric, were not really just a mirror of each other. There were quite important differences. But both of them were quite a complex mix of progressive and reactionary elements. And in both movements, reactionary elements in the end have won. They overcame those quite weak progressive elements they had. These two mass movements, they indeed had grassroots components, which were important, and they were indeed some progressive libertarian initiatives in both of them. But both of these movements had a right-wing leadership and political representation. They were both heavily influenced by the foreign powers. They both were had quite strong nationalist feelings. And there were strong far-right components in both of them. That's especially important to understand in arguing with those who truly believe that what is happening in Donbass is kind of like anti-fascist struggle against the fascist state. It is not. And it's logically, but in the same time, both movements had just and important social grievances against corrupt oligarchic state of our previous president, Viktor Yanukovych, which provoked Maidan, and social grievances also behind the movement against the new oligarchy government, but also with a quite overt neoliberal and nationalist agenda, the post-Maidan government. But in both these cases, the social grievances were channeled into the struggle between nationalism and imperialism, logically producing as a civil war, austerity and neoliberal reforms, and also militarization of the Ukrainian state and quite strong nationalist hysteria, both in Ukraine, in Russia, and also in the separatist part of eastern Ukraine. And what about the left? What should Ukrainian left do in this situation of mass movements, but with quite strong reactionary agendas? The left in Ukraine were facing the dilemma of participation. So either we participate in this, quite doubtful, and very doubtful movements with the strong reactionary elements, or we abstain from the most important political events in our country. And many on the left made the choice to participate and actually try to do something there, to bring some leftist agenda there, to reinterpret the grievances of protesting people in some more leftist progressive way. But in both cases, they failed. For example, in Maidan, the participation of the left was very much disorganized. Very small groups were trying to participate in different places without any significant impact on what was going on. And in the end, they were becoming something like voluntary supporters of the right-wing forces, which were much stronger on Maidan and on anti-Maidan as well. And the organized political interventions were extremely weak in comparison with the strength of the right-wing forces. And when, for example, the right sector was able to propose its own strategy of mass street violence against the police, which started in January last year, the left was thinking Were we able to propose our own strategy for Maidan movement, for the struggle against Viktor Yanukovych? And they tried to initiate the strikes, and but eventually they failed. They were able to start a small strike initiative only in one university where they had previously better connections and better support from the students. But even in this university, they were not were able to gain support from the majority of the students. Many of them were conformist and following the line of the mainstream Maidan leadership. And in the end, the left were not making any political impact on the way the Maidan movement developed. And in the same time, the anti-Maidan left, although they were more visible and more recognizable in anti-Maidan movement, particularly in Kharkov, the big eastern Ukrainian city, Odessa, the big city in southern Ukraine, where the Communist Party of Ukraine or Borodba movement were indeed in the leadership of those initiatives. But when the armed struggle started in eastern Ukraine, in Donbas, with the arrival of the armed group of Igor Strelkov, who started the armed rebellion in Slavyansk, and then it was the start of the so-called People's Republic in Donetsk and Lugansk and so on. The dynamics of the armed struggle was overtaken what the mass peaceful rallies which were happening in Odessa and Kharkov. And they were not really important anymore. And in the structure of the new People's Republics, so-called People's Republics that the separatists initiated, the Russian nationalists and probably the people directly connected to the Russian government were much more important than any leftist-minded person that could be involved into that initiatives. So in the end, the left participating in the movements with the strong reactionary agenda were not able to turn them into some progressive way, but only became the left wing of right-wing movements. And that's a tragedy of Ukrainian left, and that's something we have to reflect now and thinking how to avoid it. And what we have now with the left movement in Ukraine. So now we do not have any left party in the parliament, even declaratively on the left. The Communist Party of Ukraine, which is coming from the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, for many years was the major left forces, at least declaratively left, represented in the parliament. And although they gradually they were losing their support, and by 2014 they had just for the last election they were able to get into the parliament, they got something like 5%. But in 2014, in October, they were not able to get into the parliament at all. So they got much less than 5%, and there is no any left political representation in Ukrainian parliament. Moreover, the left organizations and parties are losing membership. The Communist Party, for example, lost, at least they said on their congress, they lost something like 8,000 members by the end of 2014. So this is really a deep crisis. There is much less leftist protest activity now. Though the protest events where the left is able to participate, and I have some statistics, but I don't have the equipment to show it, but what we see is a decline of the leftist protests by the end of 2014. In the same time, we are confronted with the anti-communist mobilization, many attacks on the Soviet monuments, a lot of discussions against the left, and this is not just about the monuments, actually. This is a much higher level of repression. Again, we have some statistics which show the increase of the number of cases of repressions against the left in very different forms, and both by the state and non-state actors, so primarily by the far right, but also by the police and prosecutor office, law enforcement agencies. These are physical attacks against the communist activists, or the agitators for the parties. These were attacks against the CPU offices. The state authorities and law enforcement more frequently used arrests. They were banning the peaceful assemblies that the left were trying to organize. And the so-called decommunization laws, which were recently passed by Ukrainian parliament and signed by Ukrainian president, which are not just about Stalinism, actually, that some of the left were trying to whitewash them. These laws effectively banned the whole Bolshevik tradition. So if literally taking those laws, you cannot, for example, cite in a positive way neither Lenin nor Trotsky nor any Soviet leader, even Gorbachev, who was actually destroying the Soviet Union. And many of the debates about those laws are focused on the history, that we cannot interpret Soviet history in a positive way, and in the same time we cannot denounce what the so-called denounce the so-called nationalist fight, the fighters for the national independence of Ukraine, meaning many quite ugly organizations in Ukrainian history with who were participating in who collaborated with Nazis and who were participating in ethnic cleansings during the Second World War. But it is not just about history, it's also about the current politics. For example, the communist propaganda is effectively banned, and the Communist Party will have to change its name and its symbolics. It's actually already changing. And recently they initiated the so-called coalition called Left Opposition, which is actually quite funny for the movement connected with Stalinists, but they don't think about that. I'm not actually sure they have this historical understanding of what's called the Left Opposition in the 1920s. But to some extent, this is an attempt to avoid the communist laws, but at the same time, they are moving into coalition with even uglier forces like the Progressive Socialist Party of Ukraine, which is only in its name a socialist party, but effectively this is a very strong, this is a party with a very strong Russian nationalism, even xenophobia, even with some racist attitudes. And so this move is actually not to the better, but to the worse of the development for this Communist Party of Ukraine tradition. And some analysts interpret these decommunization laws as a kind of like preventive attack on any left force in Ukraine in expectation for social protests against austerity and war, so to prevent any real political opposition in the country. But the problem is that the state is not really attacking the new left outside of the Communist Party and outside of Borodva organization, which was really like heavily involved into the separatist struggles. And the overall number of repressions and violent attacks is also high, particularly against the former members of the Party of Regions, the Party of Viktor Yanukovych, and against the separatist activity in general. So you can say that this is the state which tries to defend itself against the separatist threat, and they perceive at least some part of the left as part of the threat. But in the same time, there is really an purely anti-communist dimension to that, because no one is trying to ban the Party of Regions, although they were much more involved into the crimes of Viktor Yanukovych regime, and they try to ban only CPU and the Bolshevik tradition in general. And maybe they're not attacking the new left only because they are too marginal and perceived as not really dangerous for the state. So that's a problem. And also the last thing in the describing the current situation with the left, that the separatist people's republics should not be perceived as any kind of leftist alternative to Ukrainian government. They are not. They, in some dimensions, they may be even more reactionary, although it doesn't make them as something, as some absolute evil, but in terms of, for example, of labor legislation they are developing now, in terms of attitudes towards gender initiatives, for example, they are even more conservative than the Ukrainian government. And, for example, the trade union activity in the separatist-controlled parts of Donbass is much more difficult to wage it compared to Ukrainian part of Ukraine. And these People's Republics, they can tolerate the Soviet symbolics as some part of the so-called anti-fascist struggle, but they are not tolerating the leftist politics. And any leftist politics in clear opposition to the leadership of the separatists would be repressed, probably even with harder actions than in Ukrainian part of Ukraine. And just recently, you know probably about the murder of Alexei Mozgovoy, who was the most sympathetic to the left leader of the separatist forces. But even he was murdered, presumably by either by separatist leadership or by the Russian agents who were not interested in having any independent leader within the separatist forces. And which lessons we have to draw from this situation? First, we have to really understand how the Soviet communist tradition became essentially a conservative tradition. How the Communist Party of Ukraine, which were for many years trying to defend the remnants of the Soviet welfare state against the neoliberal reforms in the independent Ukraine, and this was essentially a social conservative project, defending what we had before, but not developing the strategy to fight for the socialist future. But at the same time, it was degrading also into political conservatism, essentially supporting Viktor Yanukovych during Maidan revolt, when all communist MPs voted for repressive laws of the January 16, which then provoked the mass violence on the streets. And also, even before that, they degraded into cultural conservatism, becoming essentially the party with a very strong Russian nationalist attitudes, avoiding any real criticism of Russian state. And even in dimensions of like gender or racist struggles, there were really some really ugly conservative attitudes from some of the members of this party, or at least they were not really taking these things as important. The second lesson is that the left truly need a party. So the left party is indispensable for the left struggles. During the recent years, the movements like Occupy and many other anarchist mobilizations were quite strong in arguing that the party is really unnecessary. But what we see in the result that in the critical turning points, the left is becoming just unarmed against the right-wing forces, against reactionary forces. The left may not have an organizational tool to struggle. And that's precisely what happened during Maidan and anti-Maidan movement, where we had a number of dispersed, small, local leftist initiatives, which were not able to make a crucial impact on what was going on in those movements. They were not able to fight for hegemony. And for this, we need an organization with a strong political consciousness and with its own independent strategy. This is essentially party. And the third lesson, that the left needs its social base in the working collectives. And this may sound as very orthodox, but it is true. What we saw in Maidan, that when the left is trying to base its strategy on the, for example, on the students, and in the end it results with support only from the students of elite universities, they cannot make any change. the workers which can start the strikes, this is the most important part of our strategy. This is what we have to try to bring, try to make connections and try to mobilize. So if the left doesn't have support among the working collectives, it becomes politically irrelevant at the critical points where there is indeed there are indeed opportunities for changing the power, as it was during Maidan movement. And the final lesson, I feel that we really need to reconstruct the whole foundations of contemporary leftist analysis. Because we have to analyze how so many people coming on the one side from the liberal and postmodern libertarian left became like voluntary supporters of the EU, and they were generally arguing that EU is more progressive than Russia, for example, because EU is more gender friendly and Russia is more conservative. And so we have to support Maidan, so we have to support Ukrainian government. And they are now even arguing that NATO is more progressive. And we have to understand how it happens. And I think it's, on the other side, there are many people who would argue that Russia is more progressive, that Russia is some remnant of the Soviet Union, and in this competition with US imperialism, this is some alternative. And not being really not giving any serious critique of what they are doing in Eastern Ukraine and with Crimea, and inside Russia, which is actually promoting quite harsh neoliberal policies, and they were starting some neoliberal reforms even earlier than Ukrainian government, for example, with labor legislation, which Ukraine still has the Soviet labor code coming from the 1970s, but Russia changed it much earlier. And I think this is coming from the 1960s, and this is a general crisis of, on the one hand, of postmodern left, which became unable, actually, which started to prioritize non-class issues over the class struggle. And on the other hand, this is a crisis of anti-imperialist left, which also gradually were starting to prioritize anti-imperialist struggle. And in their concrete meaning, this was quite frequently struggles in support of local dictators who were progressive only because they were anti-American. And in the end, this is also the way to forget about the class struggle and also to prioritize non-class issues. And I don't mean that the other issues, except of the class, are not really important. They are important. But we have to understand them, we have to analyze them, and we have to bring them into on the basis of our independent class position and independent class struggle. Otherwise, we could become just what happened with Ukrainian left, supporters of NATO against Russia or of Russian nationalism against Ukrainian nationalism. And a few words, what can we expect in how the events in Ukraine will develop from my point of view? So the social grievances against the new government are growing. More people, actually the support for the ruling parties are quite low. For example, the party of the prime minister, Arseniy Yatsenyuk, now has something like 5% of support. When in autumn, something like 20% voted for them. Petro Poroshenko, the president, is the most popular politician in the country, but even he has support of something like 10-12%. So the alienation alienation against the Ukrainian mainstream politicians is high and it is growing, and more people are saying about the prices, about the the unemployment, about the falling rate of the national currencies. And there are a number of local social protests where the people are trying to bring these issues, although they are not able at this moment to move this local protest into some all-national mass campaign against the government. And one of these reasons may be the war, that many people are still feeling that in the situation of the war, it is not appropriate to fight against your own government. This is the consequences of the patriotic mobilization. But also we have to understand that at some point, the tiredness from the war, the desire for peace will overcome. And it's only a matter of time. When the people will not believe that this war will be that Ukraine will be able to win this war, at this point the people will turn their anger against the Ukrainian government from Russians and separatists. They have anger now, and but the problem is that if the mass social protests erupt in the near future, unfortunately, they will unlikely be led by the left, because the left is very weak. They will rather be led by the far right or by some oligarchic phony project to exploit the social grievances in the struggle between the different oligarchic clans in Ukraine. But it is important to understand that it is still possible to have a legal leftist political activity in Ukrainian part of Ukraine, if not be directly connected to the separatist activity, to support for Russian politics and to support for the previous government of Viktor Yanukovych. That's why that we are at the moment of creating the social movement party, and I'm actually a member of the political council of this new party, where we want to try to unite the workers from Western Ukraine and from the Eastern Ukraine on their common class interests, not on their feelings towards Maidan or anti-Maidan, towards the previous government, towards the new government, but try to speak to what they have in common. And they share a lot of their social grievances, and they share their class interests. And so we try to mobilize it, and we try to directly and strongly work with the trade unions. And actually, some of the independent trade unions are very interested to have a political representation for them on political level. And if organized and if following an independent class strategy, the left may become at least a recognizable opposition in Ukraine in the situation when the new social protests will arise. And at this situation, if having our own organizational tool, we may probably have better opportunities to become at least visible and recognizable force within the movement. And the last points were what actually the Western European left can help us and what you can do regarding Ukraine. So first of all, you cannot give any support to either Kyiv government or to the separatists. These are essentially reactionary forces. And it is just ridiculous to argue who is more progressive and who is less progressive, who is more gender friendly and who is like less gender friendly, who is more fascist and who is like less fascist. There are you need to have a principled positions against the far right and against reactionary forces, both in pro-Ukrainian and separatist pro-Russian camps. You better should support initiatives for the dialogue within Ukraine and for your reconstitution of Ukraine from below. So indeed, Ukrainian state have to be reconstituted because many people, this is a civil war situation, but many people feel very deep anger against each other. And what Ukraine needs now is trying to discuss what another country, what a different country we need. Something like Ukraine, another Ukraine is possible. And obviously you should support all initiatives to unite workers from Eastern Ukraine and from Western Ukraine based on their class interests against Russian and Ukrainian nationalisms and against EU, US and Russian imperialisms. And of course, you need to mobilize against any anti-communist initiatives coming from Ukrainian government and against repressions of the left and independent social activists in Ukraine and also in the separatist areas controlled by pro-Russian forces. And the last thing, what we really need your support is in the campaigns to cancel Ukrainian foreign debt. And again, I have some statistics, but I could show this curve, which is going something like this. And this is Ukrainian foreign debt. And in 2015, it will be something like 40 billion of British pounds. And this is comparable to the size of Ukrainian GDP. So the situation is developed like in Greece. And like in Greece, where we see some such shameful decisions of Syriza leadership. But one of the reasons why they do this is actually they don't see a strong support from European left. Or at least European left is not able to force their own governments to go and concede to just Greek demands. And this situation that we have to avoid in case of Ukraine. We have to avoid another Greece in Ukraine, and we also have to avoid another Ukraine in the European Union. So essentially we share the same enemies, imperialisms and nationalisms and other reactionary forces. So let's struggle together and please support us in our struggle for the just and social Ukraine.
Thanks for both of the speakers today. Really, really interesting and really, really happy to get that perspective that it is a situation where you do have two imperialisms fighting against each other. I was in Sevastopol a couple of years ago and I was with some friends, Russian friends, on a so-called Russian council estate. It was interesting to see the slight ethnic tensions, which were, I wouldn't say ethnic tensions, but nationalist tensions, which were developing in this period, having Russian flag, somebody crosses it out and then graffitis a Ukrainian flag over it and stuff like this. So it's happening on a social level, kind of house by house, village by village within these areas. It's an important aspect to remember. It's very, very complicated, the integration of these two communities with each other. That's from the nationalist perspective. The other thing which I want to say just very briefly is that it's really, really important that, I did hear earlier in the year some comrades on the left talking about, giving support for Putin because he is this anti-US imperialism, anti-EU kind of imperialism. And please make no mistake, I've got activist friends out in Russia and I was with them last summer in Russia and they're tearing their hair out over the fact that that everybody is getting whipped up into this kind of nationalist ferment on both sides. And by supporting Putin, what you're doing essentially is you're supporting a system, you're supporting a regime which is acting against the interests of the working class in Russia as well. It makes it more difficult for those people to organize effective resistance to the oligarchic, nationalistic regime which you have in Russia, which has a very, very, powerful propaganda arm as well. Not just talking about the kind of information war which they've put out there with things like Russia Today, but actually inside Russia, hiding the information of what's actually happening in Ukraine by giving 3, 4, 5, 6 different perspectives on the same story to hide all kind of Russian complicity and hiding the truth from that. So that's more or less it. Thanks.
First, thank you for both speakers. I feel very sympathetic toward the Ukrainian issue. Being myself originally from Syria, I know what you're going through, this kind of person, I see them all the time. Like, for example, you were all fascist on Maidan, we were all Salafist in Syria, so we're used to it. when it comes, I could totally agree on the necessity to oppose all kinds of imperialism. And also, I think we need to change our vocabulary when we speak about so-called anti-imperialist US. I think they are not anti-imperialist. We should say it. That saying only death to America doesn't mean that you're anti-imperialist. Has nothing to do with anti-imperialism. As you said, anti-imperialist is being against a system, against all kind of different imperialist state or capitalist countries opposing themselves. And this is very important for me to put it forward. Just as peace, you know, Stalinist political parties in these kinds of regions were allied, especially in Ukraine, to oligarchic system. And there's a history, as you explain, of chauvinistic Russian nationalism that you have the same inside of Russia with the Stalinist Communist Party supporting Putin, etc., which is a catastrophe, which Russian regime is a reactionary state on all bases. And when we analyze the capitalist system in Russia, it's a mafia-style capitalist system allied with the Orthodox Church, etc. This said, I think, and I agree with you, opposing all kind of imperialism. But Ukraine is facing, we should say it, and you didn't talk a lot about it, a massive military intervention from Moscow. And acknowledged by Putin, Crimea was taken on a so-called referendum where no one was allowed to vote against it or to at least do a campaign for the no. You had activists inside of Crimea that were transferred to Russian prisons. You have massive military intervention acknowledged by Putin on television, saying going into the separatist areas, etc. So this year you have a massive difference. I'm all for opposing every kind of intervention. And when I see only people opposing Western intervention, where you have boots on the ground of Russia, it's not the same. There's a qualitative difference. This does not mean that we deny opposing all intervention, but I would like you to react on this, please.
Last February, Tomaš and I went down to the Maidan Square. It's quite interesting that, I can see why Volodymyr Zakharpovich, the Kiev left, deliberately didn't go down. It was a spectacle of the most reactionary nationalism. Tomaš and I were talking to two young students at the end who expressed the view that the Ukrainians in eastern Ukraine were mentally ill, and this is why they were so open to all the Russian propaganda and so forth. Really horrible stuff. See, the neither east nor west position is not only about uniting workers of different states and different countries. In the Ukrainian case, it's absolutely an essential, a precondition, in my view, to being able to unite Ukrainian workers, both east and west. See, I absolutely agree that we need to try and find ways in Ukraine, the left in Ukraine needs to find ways to fight for the common class interests of workers in Ukraine over economic questions, over struggle against the oligarchs and so on. But my fear is this, that without that element of addressing the national question, neither West nor East, we can't start to break through the divisive nationalisms that are dividing Ukrainian workers. And you see, the ruling class, I think, understands this. This was never about the independence of Ukraine, the self-determination of Crimea, or the self-determination of Donbass and the East. This was about how do you divide workers in Ukraine along nationalist lines so that the oligarchs and the ruling class can come out on top. And the tragedy in Russia with Boris Kagalitsky on the one hand saying that Putin isn't going in hard enough, is not giving enough support to the separatists and so on the one hand, this reinforces the situation in which the Russian anti-war movement is left in the hands of the neoliberals and so forth. And finally in this, some years ago, I think it used to be said sometimes, well, the argument about state capitalism is sort of not relevant anymore. Well, I was always unhappy with this. Always unhappy. The reason why it remains relevant in terms of the East European left is this, is the two principles on which it was founded. The emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class itself. One. Two. an absolute class opposition to imperialism as a system. Those were the two founding principles, and they remain as important now, not least in Eastern Europe, as they did at the time of the Cold War.
Hello, Tim from Norwich. I just want to build on what other people said. Before anything else, self-determination doesn't come through having Russian tanks on the streets. That looks like something out of the Cold War. That's a disgusting position. But the real tragedy is large parts of the British left and the Western left are actually arguing a very, very similar position. That's the real tragedy happening. I want to talk about that because we have a Stop the War group in Norwich and we are in a minority over this position, and we're having speakers such as John Rees and Lindsay German come up, and we've had some furious arguments with them. And I think it starts from, you have to look at it in terms of class. Do you believe the working class is a serious power in the world? Engels wrote 150 years ago that there's another great power in Europe, and that's the power of the working class. And that's what we look to, not just now, but a perspective for the future of what working people can do, and that's missing from large sections of the left. So they are arguing that basically the US is the main imperial power and Russia is a defensive action. They're arguing this, and they're winning the argument in Stop the War movement, which is a disaster. They're also, in a meeting, we made an intervention, we argued, what about Bosnia? We need to look to the working class. The left needs to look to an independent position. And if you want an example of how to do that, what about Bosnia? What about Serbia, where you've had general strikes and the kind of nationalisms that rip that area of Europe apart are much weaker, and now the working class is much stronger, and there's a left emerging. I don't know how much of that is true, and I'd like the speakers, if they could come back on that question. Is Bosnia what happened in the civil war in the early 1990s and situation today where you've had general strikes and where the nationalisms are now undercut by a class position? Lindsay German pointed me out in the room in the Stop the War meeting and said that the comrade over there is living in fantasy land and there's no possibility of that happening in the Ukraine. This is fact. I want to say this because, not because I'm a sectarian, but I think it's important to say, it's a very important person in the Stop the War movement saying it's fantasy land, that there's any other position. So we asked her, what do you think's the solution? And she said the solution was some kind of UN peace treaty that partitioned the Ukraine. In another meeting, I also was told that basically the main enemy is at home and that you can't have a position of denouncing both American imperialism and Russian imperialism, and this was John Rees looked at me and said, how can you have that on a placard? I did shout back across the room, neither Washington nor Moscow. He did dismiss me. But the situation is, it stems from class and from the 30 years of low-level class struggle, because they don't see the working class as any serious power, so they look to other people. And in that meeting as well, someone got up and made this intervention and said, the Crimea has always been part of Russia, and Comrade got up and said, Scotland has been part of the UK longer than the Crimea has been part of Russia. What are you talking about? This isn't proper history, this is rubbish. And they've got tanks on the street, but we didn't win the argument. So I think for Socialist Worker and for the left in Britain, we have a serious task to win the Stop the War movement over. And that starts in Norwich, it stops all across the country, and it starts overall. So thanks.
Hello, my name is David, I'm from Barcelona. For many years I was one of the organisers of the anti-war movement in Catalonia, now of the United Anti-Fascist Movement. A couple of things. The main enemy is at home, but that doesn't mean the only enemy is at home. It doesn't mean that your enemy's enemy is your friend. I think these should be very basic points. I think it's very sad what I've heard about the Stop the War movement here. In Catalonia, the anti-war platform hasn't done anything about Ukraine because it can't agree a position, so it just keeps quiet. I think that's a sensible position. Unite Against Fascism, we have people in favor of Donetsk and people who are against that and also against all fascism, but as Unite Against Fascism, we just don't say anything. We've got enough work to do in Catalonia without getting involved in that. The Communist Party in Spain is more of a force than it is here, which is not saying much, but there's young communists from Spain have gone to fight in international brigades in Donetsk. There are photos of them, say 20 youngish men with their flags. You have the Serbian fascists, you have the French fascists of the type of people that killed Clément Méric a few years back, and then these Spanish communists, all in the same platoon, saying they're fighting fascism. This is stupid. This is a total... it's crap. This is, in fact, there's a Russian intellectual called Alexander Dugin, who for many years, he was one of the founders of the National Bolshevik Party. They have the Nazi flag, but with a hammer and sickle in place of the swastika. He's been pushing for years the convergence between Stalinism and fascism. This is what you have in Donetsk. And the worry is, this is what they're bringing back to Spain. There was a brutal attack on a Ukrainian tourist in Barcelona last year. He'd gone to a meeting about Donetsk and tried to raise some arguments. He probably had illusions in Maidan, but he didn't deserve to spend 3 months in coma in intensive care. Finally, I think it's important that we raise arguments, we have patient arguments with people who sometimes say very stupid things. I think, as Rob said before, the arguments about socialism from below, neither Washington nor Moscow, and about how the USSR was state capitalism, these are key arguments that we won't win masses of people, perhaps, but at least we can hold a line, at least we can make sensible proposals. And if the comrades in Ukraine are able to push the idea of workers' unity across these divisions, that's really good, that can be hopeful. But I think that also within that, you have to have a core of people that aren't just saying workers must unite, forget about the differences. We actually have to have those analyses, otherwise it would be much more difficult to find our way through. And I think, well, in Catalonia, I think we've had some progress. We had a declaration, which is only a piece of paper, but at least it got support and raised the argument about saying anti-imperialism means, yes, against NATO, against the West in first place, but never supporting other imperialist powers, always supporting the struggles from below, whether they're against the Russian government, against the Chinese government, against Assad, against anybody. Workers of the world unite, not bosses of the world.
I've got a lot more hands up, I'm afraid, than I'm going to be able to take, because we are going to have to bring the speakers back in a while. I'm going to limit people to 2 minutes now, I'm afraid, and I've only really got time for about two more. So the comrade here and the comrade in the middle there, and then there was a comrade.
My name is Christine and I'm from Germany, and I think it's a real tragedy that we see a situation where the German militarism and also NATO are using the Ukraine crisis for an immense militarization. For example, we are just facing a new white book of the German army, and it's a key point is the new situation, the confrontation with Russia, and it's a huge argument for rearming the German army, not only to be able to go to Afghanistan and to foreign countries, but also to buy more tanks, for example, and to be able to fight against Russia in future times. Germany plays an important role in the very high readiness task force of NATO, and we have a huge number of maneuvers at the Baltic Sea, and this is a very dangerous development. And at the same time, the anti-war movement is not able to mobilize and not able to relate to normal people because of this position, not being able to criticizing Russia or Putin. And I think this is so what you told and the experiences you told from Ukraine are so important for the debate also in Germany, because we have to really establish in the anti-war movement, in the left, another tradition, another experience, to be able to fight also, or to reorganize the anti-war movement, because this is crucial. We need a strong anti-war movement with another political tradition that really can fight against this new cycle of armament we see at the moment. And so I think it's important to see that Karl Liebknecht didn't only say that you have to fight your enemy at home, he also said that you have to fight the warmongers in every country. And I think this is what we have to do.
Thank you.
I want to address the point Volodymyr made about the role of the left with it as the crisis developed, because as socialists, we don't take a position that we stand by any capitalist state. They're all organs of class rule. And how you position yourself depends on the content from below. And if you look at, if you compare Scotland, and I believe somebody mentioned Scotland, Scotland with what's happened in the Ukraine, we had the potential of having a horrible, you know, Scottish nationalist campaign on the one side and a British nationalist campaign on the other side. The left was able to intervene and to change the character of it. So that at the end of the day, it wasn't Scottish workers against British workers by voting for independence in the referendum. It was actually a fight against austerity. They had their agendas, you know, both the Scottish, the would-be Scottish ruling class and the British ruling class had theirs. But from below, it was able to change. And that, in a sense, is why it's so important we don't just talk about the international dimensions, but the hope is that, you know, the future depends on organisation on the ground in the Ukraine of the workers to actually change the agenda, because that's the only way we can break out of this.
I'm going to give comrades a chance to sum up. So we'll start with Volodymyr if you want to come back and...
Thank you very much for all the contributions to the discussion. Two points I really need to address. First, about the self-determination. It's a real disaster that so many people on the left are analyzing it as a kind of what happened in Ukraine as a struggle for self-determination. And likewise, the comrade made an argument that Crimea and Donetsk were self-determining themselves in, as becoming a Russian puppets. I know people who are, have very strong arguments that Ukraine itself was fighting for determination, to determine itself against Russia, against Russian colonial oppression, historical oppression, but only to become the puppets of the Western imperialism. And if we are trying to seriously make these arguments, it's just a disaster for our analysis. It doesn't worth anything if you want to... this self-determination is worthless if in the end we are becoming just a completely dependent country, dependent on the Western credits and on the Western help, also military help, unable to fight the separatists. And on the other hand, if the fight against the neoliberal nationalist government is ending in the fight for some Russian puppet states without any future without Russian supports. That's precisely what we have to avoid. And of course, the discussion about the national question is crucial here, but also it's important to discuss and analyze national question in Ukraine, not from some liberal positions that these are bad and these are bad, but from some Marxist theory and also based on the class politics. The analysis of national questions should be organically involved into the politics of the Ukrainian working class. And on the military intervention of Moscow, from Russia, it's indeed, it makes a difference that Russians are in Ukraine, but not so many Western specialists or Western soldiers are in Ukraine. But it's important to understand why it is, why it happens like this. And if U.S. have a very loyal and dependent government in Ukraine, they don't really need to intervene militarily. They can fight the war with Russia, with Ukrainian soldiers. And this is the real tragedy of Ukraine. And on the other hand, we have to analyze why Russia is involved into military intervention. Is it the nature of Russian regime? Is it something really like Hitler's Germany, which had to expand militarily, which had to start the Second World War? Or is it more something like defense of its sphere of influence? And it doesn't mean that we have to support Russian pretensions for its own sphere of influence. We cannot be Putin understanding leftists. But on the other hand, we have to analyze if it is a defensive action or is it really a step to some kind of like world domination, what Hitler, for example, was aspiring for. And I don't really see an analysis why Russians will go forward as Nazi Germany, for example. Is it truly embedded into the nature of Russian capitalism? Or it is rather something different?
Tomaš,
Okay, I just want to make sort of three points. I think the what's really comes out when we're discussing the crisis in Ukraine is about the importance for socialists to put forward an independent working class perspective and start from the standpoint of the working class rather than going along with either one imperialist camp or the other. And I just want to sort of touch on a couple of issues in terms of that. First of all, when it comes to the question of peace within Ukraine, I think that we have to sort of address this. I mean, what do we mean by peace? I mean, you find a lot of people saying now that we're for peace in Ukraine. If you just had some sort of UN peace treaty or some kind of imperialist ceasefire and then the equivalence of the Dayton Accords in Bosnia, that sort of agreement, you would simply embed those sort of nationalist divisions that are already taking place and institutionalize them. What you do need to actually have is to say, we're fighting against the war and we're fighting against imperialism, and that means breaking the working class from those nationalist ideas on both sides. You can't just say peace in some sort of abstract way. You've got to actually look at the political content of what that means. And it's not true that there's a sort of long history of the nationalist divisions with sort of being there from the very beginning. You did see actually both the amount of Ukrainian and Russian speakers being bilingual and so on and so forth, but it was a conscious attempt by successive Ukrainian governments to pump up Ukrainian nationalism in order to sort of build support for themselves, and also by Russia to pump up greater Russian chauvinism to build up support for themselves at home. So I think that's important to say, that there is always a basis for building that sort of unity. These aren't some sort of natural kind of divisions that exist. When it comes to, just briefly, when it comes to the question of national self-determination, we support self-determination for oppressed people. So therefore, in Crimea, we support the national self-determination of the Tatars, who were deported by Stalin, who were... And actually, the idea of giving, of Khrushchev giving sort of Crimea to Ukraine from Russia was actually to try and sort of stamp out any claim that they would have, that sort of Tatars would have over it. So I think that's sort of important to say. It's not on the basis of majority votes. It's about fighting against reactionary ideas and striking a blow against imperialism, supporting Russia's annexation of the Crimea strengthens reactionary ideas and it strengthens imperialism. So, I mean, that's why we support national liberation as socialists. The other thing I want to say is that, obviously, Russia does have sort of troops and sort of specialists, etc., within Ukraine. But for us within the West, for us in Britain, even if they were pouring in hundreds of thousands of Russian tank columns, if the skies above Kiev were blacked out by Russian bombers, we would still oppose our own government, because we have to fight against our own ruling class as part of that struggle against the imperialist system. That doesn't mean, though, that we are silent on the question of Russian imperialism. When Karl Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg and Lenin were arguing, saying we need to fight against our own imperialist governments, they didn't say we're going to be silent on Tsarist Russia or we're going to be silent on German imperialism. They still fought against that, but you need to fight against your own government in order to try and strike a blow against that system. And when it comes to the Stop the War movement here, we have to be part of it. It would be, you know, the worst kind of sectarianism not to be. We mobilized 2 million people onto the streets in the fight against Islamophobia, what the government is putting forward. Stop the War is going to be crucial. But the job of Stop the War is to oppose any wars by our own government, not to have positions on all these sort of different things. We can argue for our perspective within it, but we also have to be part of it, and that is crucial. But I just want to sort of finish that there is that sort of basis for unity between the workers when it comes to Bosnia. But what Bosnia does show, actually, was that you could have, after years of sectarianism, the basis for unity, but also when it's just based on sort of community initiatives, plenums, they're great, but you also need to be based on the organized working class, because that's where the power within society lies. So when it comes to solidarity with the people of Greece, or when it comes to solidarity with Ukrainian workers, the best thing we can do is fight against our own government and make sure that the austerity they're pushing through, the imperialist wars they're pushing through, they don't succeed, because on that basis we can weaken our own ruling classes and weaken the system that they're all part of. And for that, we need to focus on the working class and also be organized as well as socialists.